Okay, we're going to talk about entrepreneurial successes and failures. We have a distinguished panel and a panel chair and moderator that many of you know from prior events and as the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of Philadelphia, Charles Plosser. What you may not know, unless you went into the bio deeply, is before the Federal Reserve, Charlie was the dean of the Simon School at Rochester. He has a distinguished career on the entrepreneurial side, on the academic side, and on the consulting side before public service with the Federal Reserve. So it is a pleasure for me to welcome a very dear friend, Charles Plosser. Charlie, would you run your panel, introduce your panel? We're happy to have you here. And we'll welcome you and Lee Ago.
So welcome everybody. I'm pleased to be here again. This is a great event. I was here last year, and it was an exciting and interesting conference. And all the GIC conferences I've attended over the years have been fascinating, and I'm privileged to be a part of this. This is a great panel. It's going to be fascinating. I'm going to start by teeing up just a few questions of my own, sort of related to what David just did. As David alluded to, this is a conference in some ways about successes and failures. I spent a lot of my years as an academic, as David said. And one of my mentors many years ago when I was a graduate student was a man by the name of Milton Friedman. And Milton often told us that free markets and economics and capitalism was not just about the freedom to succeed. It's also about the freedom to fail. Without failure, capitalism and markets don't work very well. And when you think about that in the context of entrepreneurial activity, one of the great things about entrepreneurs is that not only are they innovative and creative and risk takers, they also know what it's like to fail. Not one entrepreneur that I've ever known, while they tout their successes, they have lots of failures under their belts as well. And oftentimes they'll say they learn as much from their failures as they do from their successes. And it teaches them what perhaps not to do in the future. So one of the things that's very important about this panel, and I hope each of them will talk about, is not just about their successes, but about their failures and what they learn from them. Because that's really important. But failure brings me to another question I think is important. And it's about risk-taking. It's about entrepreneurial activity. One of the great dynamisms of our economy, in any market economy, is entrepreneurial activity. In the United States, about 40% of our labor force, 40% of our employment, are in companies that contain 50 employees or less. 40% of our economy are employed in small companies of that nature. That's a very big number. So when our economy grows, when our market economy grows, it is growing because of entrepreneurs, of small businessmen. And I think one of the interesting questions that David raised that I want to reiterate is, what does the environment look like today for entrepreneurs? The Great Recession, the financial crisis, have taken their toll on our economy. They've changed the way policymakers view the world, it seems like. You've got the Federal Reserve System with interest rates very low, trying to be accommodative. You've got the Fed saying at times, we want people to take risks. We want people to take more risk, encourage risk-taking, particularly in the financial markets. Have we been successful at that? On the other hand, you've got other parts of government turning around and with regulations or taxes saying, no, 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 we don't want you to take risk. We want everything to be safe. So you've got this tug of war going on within our society right now about risk-taking versus not. And so I'd like for them to think about, if we look forward over the next 10 years, is this a good time for entrepreneurs? Is it a good time for risk-taking? Have we got the balance within our economy right? And I think that's really important, because if we get that wrong, there's a big price to be paid, I think. And finally, a slightly different question from my old business school days. I spent 30 some odd years teaching MBA students at one level or another. And in business school, we often talk a lot about strategy. But you know, I always wondered, I'm not an entrepreneur and never wouldn't claim to be so, but I wonder, innovation is important, and entrepreneurs innovate. They create new products, they see a need, they fill them, they figure out new ways to do things. But I oftentimes wonder, the same people in business school that we taught MBAs, we talked about strategy. So I have a question for these experienced entrepreneurs. I've heard some people tell me strategy actually can get in the way of creativity, can get in the way of being innovative. And so this interaction between being an entrepreneur and being conducting successful strategies for your businesses is important, but how do those two pieces interact? Does overattention to strategy stifle innovation and entrepreneurship? I don't know the answer to that, but I'm fascinated by the idea of how those two pieces interact. So I've said enough. I've said too much already. So let me begin. Let me just briefly introduce the panel. Their bios are in your iPads there. First, we have Rob Ryan. Rob founded Ascent Communications, sold out to Lucent Technologies, and are very successful. But more relevant today, perhaps, or at least in part of what's going on today, is he is also the founder and chairman of Hero Partners. And they are engaged in mentoring and helping young entrepreneurs, and he does a great job with that. Another panelist, Troy Downing, CEO of AC Storage Solutions. He's also a successful entrepreneur. He told me beforehand, I said, "What do you do?" He says, "I do what I like."
That's a good job.
That is a great job, isn't it? He only does what he likes, and I think that's great. He does everything from managing real estate. He has a vineyard, grows wine, and I said, "Well, it sounds like you do some really fun things," and that's when he said he only does what he likes. But he's going to talk to us as well. And last on our list is Bob Grady. He is managing director of Cheyenne Capital, a private equity firm headquartered in Denver. He's a former member of the Carlyle Group, so he has a long history and experience in private equity. He served under George Bush's administration, both as a speechwriter, director of OMB in the office of OMB, and he's now also chairman of the New Jersey Pension Funds, so a pension system. So another gentleman with broad both policy experience as well as private equity experience. So it's going to be a great panel, and I'll be quiet and turn it over to our first speaker, Rob Ryan.
Thank you.
I hope this is turned on. It is turned on. So I'm going to cover a couple of questions. The first question is, why am I here? If any of you know anything about Ascend at all, it built the modern infrastructure for the internet. And it was a wildly successful company. So I don't need to be here. I don't need to be training entrepreneurs around the United States. I could be laying on some beach anywhere in the world, but I'm not. I'll tell you why. I'm totally passionate about entrepreneurship and about entrepreneurs. You know, I live and breathe that. We mentor entrepreneurs in a whole set of ideation and innovation and strategy throughout the country. So let me tell you kind of my dream. Ascend was a wildly successful company, and it changed the ecosystem in and around the area that it was in, which was Oakland, California. It spun out other entrepreneurs because of its success and the generation of the amount of money that it created. So I said to myself, I looked at the United States right now, and I said, you know, I don't like what I've been seeing. There's a lot of people out of jobs. There's a lot of discontinuity in the terms of the American dream. About two-thirds of the people think there is no American dream anymore, including young people. So I'm thinking this is not good. And if you look at the number of startups that are actually starting, it's actually declining. All of this, I thought, is not so good. So I actually decided I'll go back to my core competency. That's entrepreneurship. I'm not a politician. I actually personally despise both sides, the Republicans and the and the Democrats. I do not think actually they can accomplish anything. So I thought about, well, how could I accomplish something? So I said, what if I had a magic wand? What if I had a magic wand and I could create 50 to 100 Ascend-like companies, Apple-like companies, hero companies, transformative companies. They get so big in their region, they spin out so many other entrepreneurs and such capital, and I could plant one or two or three in each state in the union. And I could pick them, not in the Silicon Valleys and not in the Bostons, because they already have an infrastructure of entrepreneurs, but I can pick them in Rockton, Illinois, Rockford, Illinois, Beloit, Wisconsin, you know, the Bakken fields in the Dakotas, all, in other words, all over the United States, Bozeman, Montana. So I said, okay, let's try to do that. So I start looking at that. Now, why am I doing this? My dad, you know, is a big, big force in my life. He's long since dead. He died actually younger than I am. I'm 67. And, you know, I look at that, and I saw him. You know, I heard a little bit about his fight in World War II as a Marine in the Pacific, not a really neat place, and I decided, this is my fight. This is my fight, this is my America, this is my fight. I'm going to try to reestablish jobs from the ground up through entrepreneurs. In fact, millions of entrepreneurs, and I'm going to actually try to guide you through how I'm going to do this, because you're thinking, how could he possibly do millions of entrepreneurs? But hopefully by the end of the 10 minutes or so, you'll have an idea how we're going to go about doing it. So why should you believe that I can accomplish this? I'm going to tell you a little bit about the success and failures of my company, Ascend Communications. Back in 1989, I founded it with my wife and three other engineers. We actually started with an idea to build a box about this big that was going to act as a communication device, as on-ramp and off-ramp to a new digital service that the telephone companies promised they would deploy. We built the box. We raised money, by the way, from Kleiner Perkins, Greylock, and NEA. We raised about $3 million in venture capital. And we built this box, and I was the chief executive officer, founder, marketing head, and sales head. I was sort of everything. And I'm running around looking to where I could actually sell this equipment. And unfortunately, I wasn't finding many places to sell it. The telephone companies had sort of fibbed. They weren't actually deploying the service in the manner that they said they were going to. So we had a kind of a conundrum. We actually raised a little bit more money from NEA. They were the largest investor in the world, Dick Kramlich, president of the American Venture Society. Dick came on board, and within a couple of months, it was very, very clear after Dick came on board that we could not actually sell our equipment. There was nothing to sell it to. So this is a failure. This was actually a disaster. So I had a board meeting, which I basically started by saying I have good news and bad news. The board actually kind of turned to Kramlich and said, what do you want to hear first, Dick? And he said, well, let's hear the bad news. And I said, well, here, the bad news is there's no place to sell the equipment. And, you know, what we could do if you want is give you what's left of your money back and terminate the company, and that's the end of it. So it wasn't exactly a great auspicious beginning for Ascend Communications. What happened is Dick Kramlich, he's been around the block with venture capitalists and with entrepreneurs for a long time. And he took his business plan that was barely 3 or 4 months old, and he threw it up in the air, my business plan. And he said, Rob, I just love startups. Why don't you tell me, you know, the new idea? What's your new idea? So I had my head of engineering, a young lady, Jeanette, go up to the whiteboard, and she started drawing out this device that would allow communications to occur between video equipment in the world. And they said, okay, well, fine, we're going to give you a little time. You're going to have to go out and find a customer this time. We're going to change the paradigm. You're not going to build products. You're going to actually get a customer to actually give you an order before you even start building. So I said, well, you know, we have no choice. We're in a failure mode right now. So I said, fine, we'll do that. So they send me off and get me to open a door to actually John Tyson, who's the head of Compression Labs, which was the largest video manufacturer at the time. Now we're in about 1990 time frame, by the way. And I'm talking to John, and I'm telling him about this fictitious box. It's a hypothetical box. And, you know, he gets very excited, and he says, I'd like two of these boxes, and I want to test these boxes. And I said, absolutely, absolutely. And I said, John, here's a bit of a problem. There's a small problem here. I do not have the box, okay, but if you give me a check for the box, I'm going to actually take that check back to the board, and then the board is going to say, oh, Rob, oh, Rob, oh, Rob, and then they're going to call you, and you're going to say it's the best thing since sliced bread, and we're going to actually get a chance to build this thing. And he, when he got done laughing, actually, John spent quite a bit of time laughing. He said, well, what's the check? How much for the check, Rob? I mean, what is the cost of the box? And I said, look, how much does it cost you today to get that amount of bandwidth? And he said, well, it cost me, $100,000 for two boxes to get that amount of bandwidth. And I said, look, John, we're going to give you a great bargain. It's going to be $50,000, $25,000 for each end, and you write me the check. And he writes the check. By the way, here I learned something right away. As an entrepreneur, from this point forward in my career, and every entrepreneur that I train, I always have the customer designing the product and get the check before I ever start any engineering. I have never started an engineering of a product without having the check and having customers. Because if you get a check from a customer before you even have anything, wow, that you got a lot of pull there. You're not pushing, they're pulling on the whole thing. So he tells me 100, I say 50, 25, 25. I just want to give you a punchline on this. That box cost me about $300 to build. I had $25,000 that I charged for each box. And so I had pretty good gross margins on that. I mean, they were fair. They were fair. And, you know, I will tell you, this is funny, I'm talking about financial. Because I am definitely not a financial guy, but I always told my board, hey, I do understand 25,000 and 300. I do understand that. So, all right, here we go. Now we build this company up to about 20 million in sales. 20 million sales profitable. My board says we have a buyer for the company. We're going to sell it for $40 million. We're going to take our money, which they had an agreement to get 2.5x of what they put in. They put in $16 million, so 2.5x is the entire $40 million. They walk away. All the employees are pretty much worked for nothing for all the years. And I said, oh, this isn't a really good program. I don't like this program. So after much discussion with the board, they gave us another chance. So I had them remember, the first failure, it permuted into not a failure, but not exactly a success either. And now they give us the next chance. The next chance is, I don't know what we're going to do. So here comes the time of innovation and the epiphany. I'm actually trapped in a cabin in the Yosemite snow, and I read a Harvard Business Review article by C.K. Prahalad on the core competencies of Honda. So imagine Honda, they have lawnmowers, they have automobiles, motorcycles, generators. What are they, a confused generator company that does cars? Or a motorcycle company that does weed whackers? No. The center of their competency is small to medium-sized combustion engines. Then they leverage that engine technology into all these other products and market areas. So I began to draw a sunflower, the center of which I had empty because I'm trying now to figure out what our core competencies, the SENS, were, and then what our petals could be. So I get back finally to work. I sit down with my team. We start this exercise. They think I'm completely crazy. They thought I actually had drugs up there in Yosemite. I did not. We ended up deciding that we do dialing, computer dialing. Different protocols, different switches, different computers, dialing. So we ask ourselves, well, how do we leverage dialing, software, and hardware? Well, we write down different categories. We write down internet infrastructure. We knew nothing about the internet infrastructure. We write down video. Well, we knew something about video. We had a business in video. We write down corporations talking to each other. We write down people commuting or telecommuting in. So we had 4 or 5 pedals we write down. At this point, I'm a logician and mathematician by training. And I actually had this epiphany that I needed to bring my entire team along with me because now they're all arguing about which direction we should go in. And so I started to ask not about the watts. Those pedals up there are the watts. We're not going to argue about the watts. I asked them to give me the whys. Give me the criteria by which their brain will decide between the different watts. So we started to write down different criteria. We wrote down the rate of growth of the market. Is the market allow us to be stealthy? Is our technology unique? Do we have any value equation with the customer, meaning we save or make money with the customer? We wrote down about 15 different criteria. At that point, it looked like we had a matrix. So I allowed the matrix to form, and we started scoring the criteria against the opportunities. And I allowed each member of my team, there were four of us in the room, to score. So each cell had four scores. And when cells did not agree in a wildly different manner, like somebody gave a 10 and somebody gave a 2, we scored 1 to 10, I would ask why. That's my favorite question in life, why? And then the person would describe the whys. And then sometimes the scores would realign. What was happening in the team is alignment of the team was occurring, and we ended up, believe it or not, with the following ranking of our opportunities. No products, remember. We were doing an innovation technique, which I've now done many, many times, to see whether we could go in a specific area. It ranked things infrastructure, internet, remote access, telecommuting, video. Video was last place. Video was our existing business. So we said, okay, well, I had all these very bright people that worked for me. We said, well, we liked the process that we did. Everyone participated. And we said, okay, let's go out to the internet. We didn't know anything about the internet. This was 1991. There were 400 internet providers out there. We divided the 400 up, 100 each. We went out and said, we're going to talk to all 400 in 6 weeks. We're going to ask them one and only one question. We have nothing to sell them. We have no product to sell them. We're going to ask them one question. And that question is, what is your pain? Where is your pain? What keeps you up at night? And here's the answer we got. We can charge $300 to $400 per subscriber to the internet. It cost us $1,000 to get a subscriber on the internet back in 1990. The economics of the growth of the internet is ridiculous. So here's how we're handling, they told me. We oversubscribe. We sell 30 subscriptions for one port on the internet. And you get blocked. Because if 30 people call, and there's one port, 29 people get blocked. This is a prescription for failure. And they understood that. So they were going out of business. It was a mess. That and the fact that there was a babble of tongues and computer protocols that they had to guess as to how people were going to dial in, with what kind of communication service. They didn't know what boxes to put in their, what they call, points of presence throughout the country. So the internet was basically stalled. I did exactly, now remember what I did earlier? I asked for an order. I said, well, I think we can build a box that solves this problem for you. And we did this, by the way, we were doing alphabetically going through. And by P for PSINet in Washington, D.C., that ISP, Internet Service Provider, was sitting in a cafe with me, and he was drawing on a napkin. I really wish I had that napkin. I don't. And he drew the box that he'd like us to build. Here we go. The customer was designing the product for us based on what he knew about our core competencies. All I had told him is about our competencies. I didn't try to sell him a video box. It had nothing to do with what he was doing. He drew the box, and I said, yeah, we can build that. And what did I do? You all know what I did. I asked for an order. I asked for an order, and once again, we did the same arithmetic, found out how much it cost him. He said it cost him 100 people, $1,000 per person, $100,000 to get 100 people on the internet. I said, great, I'll give you the box for $50,000. That box cost $800 to build. That had even a better margin than the other box did. So what happened to our company? This is where the success part comes. We just grew from 30 million to 150 million to 580 million to 1.3 billion to 2.8 billion. But we didn't stop only with this one product in the modern infrastructure, the internet. Remember those other pedals that I mentioned to you? we began to leverage our core competencies and our core technologies into each and every one of the market areas. Remember I said remote access, telecommuting, and all of those areas? We became number one in every single segment around our little sunflower. So the company grew in a prodigious manner. I want to comment on strategy. I am a true believer in strategy. And when I term strategy and teach it, I call it suffocation strategy. So allow me to tell you briefly. I don't compete to come in second place. I compete to come in first place. And I don't compete against the little companies that are surrounding me at that point in time. I look at the targets that I know are going to be competing with me. Cisco System, Alcatel, Lucent were the guys that I decided I was going to entrap, and by the time they figured out what I was doing, it would be too late. How do you do that? You take your core competencies, you get competitive information about the competitor. How did I get competitive information? Two ways. When I was doing my survey of the internet service providers, I would always ask, why are you talking to me? Why are you talking to me? Well, you could talk to Alcatel, you could talk to Cisco, and they'd say, oh, we already have, Rob. We already have. And I said, well, why aren't you doing business with WEM? Why would you do business with a little tiny company like us? And they said, well, they're not responding. They would tell me the world view of my competitors in an intimate way, as a customer knows. So now I knew that they didn't think wide area networking was important at all. I knew that they weren't doing any projects on this at all. I knew what their weaknesses were. I knew what their strengths were. I knew what their core competencies were, and I knew what my core competencies were. And so I gave the company a set of goals. We articulated the goals into very tight, measurable goals in terms of building other core competencies that would completely entrap. Let me give you an example. One of the things in communications were there were a lot of babbling protocols. You know, you can think of them as languages. German, French, Spanish, except they were communication protocols. And everybody in our industry would pick one that they liked and say, we have the best box in French, we have the best box in German, or whatever. We said, we're agnostic. We have interfaces for every piece of equipment. We make them all interwork. That was a strategy. Our competitors couldn't compete with that. They only had one or two of the types. Another strategy was international. When we were a young company, we went out to every place in the entire world and got certification on their internet. Now, a global company in the US, if it thought it might want to go with Cisco, because Cisco was a gazillion dollar company when I was a tiny company, I'd say, well, you know, do you have offices in London? Do you have offices in Paris? And they go, yeah, we do. I'd say, ask them to show you the written certifications. There is no written certifications. They hadn't any. So again, Trump, more Trumps, one after another. There were three or four interlinking strategies that we built in technology. Later on, we built strategies in channel, sales. I'll give you a quick example of that. A suffocation channel strategy in sales is as follows. We took 90% of all the internet service providers in the world had our equipment inside of their points of presence, 90%. All of the major telephone companies, about 80% of them had our equipment inside. So what I did then was we basically put code inside our boxes that were inside the internet that only could communicate with our boxes on the outside. So if you were a competitor to us, and you had a little box and you were trying to sell your little box, you could get on the internet and there would be no problem. But we would then whisper to the customer, do you want encryption? Do you want all these features? And they wouldn't work because you would have a two-way discussion with the box inside the internet, and that was our equipment. So we leveraged the competency inside the internet, another technology. In sales, when we got all the different channels and the carriers, we went out and took all the channels in the repping channels, all the representatives. So when our competitors came at us, there was no indirect channel that they had open to them. They were all gone. They had to only sell by direct sales, and therefore you grow to a monstrous company. I am a firm believer in suffocation strategies. So briefly, I'm going to quickly now segue to HERO. What we're doing with Hero is we have 25 and 30 companies right now around the United States. Many of them you're going to hear about very soon as very heroic companies. There are several of them sitting in the audience right now. And we continue to train them on the ideation process that I told you about, on the suffocation strategies and how to build that. We do everything from finding them employees, a whole host of things. We're very serious about building a hero company in these outlying regions. So we have an environmental service company that has grown from 1 million to 20 million in a year and a half that's out of Bozeman, Montana. We have a young lady that is in Beloit, Wisconsin that has grown in 3 years. She has 240 million that she's on a run rate right now. She does, and here's a comment on regulation. So when you have regulations, our government is very good at that. That's one of the best things they do, right? This becomes lemons. What an entrepreneur does is create lemonades when you have lemons. So what they did is build compliance software, mobile software that allows corporations to remain compliant, exchange documents, schedule, do all sorts of things. They grew in a couple of years to where they're processing $240 million in business. In every segment. They own 80% of all the airlines right now. They're moving into the retail, the banking, and all of the different segments. An example of an entrepreneur overcoming obstacles. I think we can transform America. We can have this intersection of the economy and entrepreneurship and create millions of entrepreneurs. And I hope I'm a part of it. I hope I live long enough with my young partners to actually do that. And thank you for listening.
I'm Bob Grady, and I'm going to follow Rob's excellent presentation. I want to start by thanking the Global Interdependence Center, because I think some of the things they're doing around the world are wonderful, from educating people in Ghana to doing this program Monday on bringing disabled Americans into the economic mainstream. But I have some slides, and since this is a global conference, and since we're going to talk about the economy and entrepreneurs, it's always good news and bad news. And so I want to start with a little story about good news and bad news. It's a global story, and it relates to the day that God decided the world was going to end. And so he did a completely logical thing. He called up President Obama, he called up President Putin of Russia, and then, appropriate since they're in the World Cup final this weekend, he called up President Cristina Fernandez Kirchner of Argentina. And he said, I have some good news and bad news. The world's going to end in 2 days. Go prepare your people. And so President Obama did a normal thing. He called the joint session of Congress. He went on national TV. There's John Boehner with a golf tan behind him and Joe Biden getting ready to fall asleep. And he got on national TV, said, my fellow Americans, I have some good news and bad news. The good news is there is a God. He's a kind and generous soul. The bad news is the world's going to end in 2 days. Go home, hug your families, tell them you love them, et cetera. President Putin, of course, didn't have too much trouble getting on Russian TV. He went on Russian TV, and being a Russian, he said, I have some horrible news and some disastrous news. The horrible news is there is a God. The disastrous news is the world's going to end in 2 days. Now, President Cristina Fernandez Kirchner, being an Argentine, she went on Argentine TV, and she said, I have some wonderful news, and I have some fantastic news. The wonderful news is there is a God. I've met him. He's an Argentine football fan. His hand has helped Maradona in the past. The fantastic news is our currency crisis will be over in 2 days. So talking about the economy, I am not an entrepreneur in that sense, but I spent my career financing entrepreneurs. I ran the venture capital arm at the Carlyle Group. I had the privilege of succeeding Dick Kramlich and Jim Breyer and others as the chairman of the National Venture Capital Association. I started my career at a firm called Robertson Stevens, my business career, which was a great underwriter of young, high-technology companies in the 1980s, 90s, including eBay, E-Trade, Dell Computer, CompuWare, AOL, and Ascend Communications, among others. And I think there's good news and bad news. So let me just start and talk about that. I was struck by that 6% answer, is the government helping you or not? Let's talk about the environment for entrepreneurs today, because I think this is a critical topic. Now, there's good news. You're here in Jackson, Wyoming. There's good news here. This is a great economy. This is the Teton County economy has recovered from the crash. It's growing very nicely, thanks to tourism, thanks to the real estate business. We have a highly educated workforce right here. 50% with bachelor's degrees or more, used to be half of that. We have 62% of all the emplanements in and out of Wyoming every year, so we have air service under like a lot of rural towns in America. Very high per capita income, very high, highly educated workforce. We have a group created by Liza Millett right here in the third row called Silicon Couloir, trying to create the environment for an entrepreneur. So we have the ability to have sort of an entrepreneurial economy here. So that's pretty good news. But what does it take to create an environment, a sort of environment for entrepreneurs, an entrepreneurial ecosystem? Well, it certainly takes a good economy. So that's another piece of good news. Here's the U.S. economy, as everybody knows, I think. Grew by 1.9% last year. Okay, not great. Shrunk by 2.9% in the first quarter, but let's assume that was an anomaly. S&P 500 and the Dow touching their all-time highs. But by the way, to put that 1.9% growth in perspective, let's just think that for the years between 1929 and 2012, for that 83 years, the average growth rate was almost 3.5%. So it's not great, and there are other places growing. So the good news, the economy is expanding, not contracting. I think the first quarter is an anomaly. Bad news, maybe not as fast as we would like. Here's the best news. We're here to talk about entrepreneurship. Charlie talked about 40% of the employees being companies 50 or less. Let me tell you, I come from the venture capital world. 60% of all the new jobs in the country in the last three decades were from companies of 500 or less. Companies that receive venture capital funding from NEA and Kleiner Perkins and Carlyle and, the 400 venture firms in the United States, today employ 11.9 million people. Now, that's 10% of all the private sector workforce in the country. And by the way, they had $2.9 trillion in sales, 21% of GDP, a year ago. And think of the amount of capital that went into them. It's about $29 billion a year last year, but it's been as low as 19 the last couple of years. So it's 0.2% of GDP of the invested capital, creating 20% of the sales in the whole U.S. economy. They've been the job-creating engine of the U.S. economy. Now, it's not just tech companies that created the internet like Ascend, it's certainly Apple and Cisco and eBay, but it's also Starbucks, it's also Home Depot, it's also FedEx. It's a range of companies in a range of industries that have been very high growth job creators. Now, how does this relate to everything? I stand here today to tell you that I think this conference and everybody should be focused on the fact that America is at a crossroads. We are standing here today in the middle of a gigantic misallocation of our national resources away from things that will encourage that entrepreneurial environment, that will make us more productive as a country in the future, and toward things that are basically a proxy for consuming more today and in some ways might even be regarded as a waste of money. Okay, does anybody know what that picture is? There's one person here who knows. It's a former mayor. That's Detroit. The crossroads hit me when I was reading the newspaper, as I sometimes do on Saturdays. I was sitting here one Saturday this spring, and I pick up the Wall Street Journal. I'm in the 46%, David. I read the Wall Street Journal. And it has a story on this page about the Detroit bankruptcy. Now, Mayor Archer's an expert. I'm not going to pretend to be an expert on the Detroit bankruptcy, but these are the figures from that paper that day. And I said, okay, they have $11 billion in debt and $2 billion in cash. They're bankrupt. I got that. The debt was comprised of $6 billion of employee retirement health care costs and $3.5 billion of pension costs. Their general obligation debt was $520 million. So they have $2 billion in cash and $500 million of GO debt. They're not running the day-to-day government that badly. They just have this giant blob of long-term obligations. Now, sitting there on my Saturday, I turn to the next page in the Wall Street Journal, and here's the next page. It's a story about Janet Napolitano taking over the UC system. Now, the University of California is one of the crown jewels of the United States. It is one of the great research universities in the world, and as Rob and others will tell you, so much IP has come out of our great universities, whether it's in biomedical research, material science, the things that enabled the internet, semiconductors, et cetera. Okay, so here's the UC system. It says that in the prior 3 years, The state support for the UC system been cut by 27%, that they'd increased tuition 26% in 2009-2010, they'd increased it another 36% in the next 2 years, it was frozen this year. And I just put down the paper and I said, this is it. Nothing else matters. This is a perfect proxy for what is going on in America, both at the state level and at the national level. And the implications are gigantic. The implications are gigantic. We are not investing in the things that will make us more productive. We are wasting our money on other things, on benefits. And that will determine how our children and their children will live in the future. That will determine the future standard of living in the United States. So here's three pictures. That's Detroit again on the bottom. That's Turkey on the upper left, the China of Europe. That's China on the right. And we're in a contest. Where is going to be the best place to form a company? Where is going to be the home of entrepreneurship? And if we don't make choices today, the answer may or may not be the United States. So let's kind of just put this in perspective. From the period of 1970 through just a couple years ago, the United States basically outgrew Europe by 2x and had half the unemployment rate, right? We grew at about twice the rate. We had half the unemployment rate. Why was that true? Why was that true? And by the way, this is what happens when you outgrow other countries. This is the implications. This is China growing at 9% for the last 2.5 decades, while everybody else grew at 1, 2, or 3. So the implications of growing faster are profound. But why is it true? Why did the entrepreneurial economy, all those companies I showed on that slide, why was it here? Because 70% of all the venture capital in the world for the last 3 decades has been invested here in the United States. Why was it here? Well, there were building blocks, okay? One piece is we had the best universities in the world. Unparalleled university research. Another one, fantastic universal public education. Another one, great infrastructure, highways, electric power, you name it. An embrace for 50 years of open trade. Access to capital for young companies, a venture capital ecosystem, public markets that let them come there, and of course, rule of law. Now here's what's interesting. Every one of those pillars is under assault today and crumbling. And let me tell you why. Now, I'm a former budget guy. I was deputy director of OMB. But everybody says, don't worry about the recession. We crashed in 07, 08. No problem. We're going to innovate our way out of it. The United States is the home of innovation. This is great. I'm for innovation. Both parties are not telling you the truth that they're for innovation by the way they budget. This is right out of the FY15 budget of the U.S. government. Okay? And this just shows you, FY14, excuse me. This is what, and you can't blame Congress for this slide, this is what the president proposed. Okay, NIH, the year before it was $30 billion, $30.2 billion, and a gigantic increase of 0.1%. And you can see the other numbers. National Science Foundation, down. And by the way, when I was in the U.S. government, individual investigators at the NIH who were applying for grants to fund their basic research were getting approved at a rate between 25 and 30% of all the applications sent in. Okay? This year, the rate is 6.5%. That's how many grants are being approved. The great scientists in the country are being denied here. And by the way, they're setting up labs and they're being recruited by Singapore, UK, lots of people around the world. What do we spend our money on? The president says, oh, I'm for R&D, I'm for science. We have single-digit increases there, and look, 16% increase in Medicaid. Now, the Republicans are just as guilty. It's a bipartisan problem because they get up and brag and say, we should take domestic discretionary portion of the budget back to FY08 levels. Well, domestic discretionary, the place we fund science, highways, energy research, transportation, infrastructure, environmental protection, that's 16% of the budget. Two-thirds of the budget, more than all the revenues we collect as a country, is entitlements and interest. So we could get rid of what everybody else thinks of the government. We don't have enough money to make the right investments. Now, you talk about sustainable business models, this is just a point about that, all right? When President Bush was elected in 1988 and I was working for him, the U.S. economy was $5 trillion. It's now three times as big, but look at that. Medicare has grown by 580%. It's 6.8 times as big. Medicaid has grown by 828%. It's 9.3 times as big. Does anybody think that's sustainable? Of course not, but what are the implications of that? Well, here's what that looks like on a chart. This is how your government is spending its money. And by the way, it's true at the federal and at the state level. The red line is healthcare. The two flat lines are R&D and education. the two things that will enable us to be the home of entrepreneurship and be more productive as a country. And the results are starting to show up all around us. So the first pillar I was talking about, university research. University research is being compromised. The UC system is being dismantled brick by brick while we're sitting here. Now here's K through 12 education. Everybody in this room knows we could spend a whole day on it. We need to reform it. But here's the results of the PISA tests run every year among the 34 OECD countries. We're 26th in math, 21st in science, 17th in reading. We've been falling in all three. So the K through 12 system is under stress. Here's infrastructure. Here's infrastructure. Electric power. All right? Demand is scheduled to grow by 28%. We're not growing our supply by 28%. Our highways, we're 18th out of those 34 industrialized countries in the quality of our highways. In terms of broadband, we're 16th among the OECD in fixed broadband. You go to Korea, you can get 10x the speed at one half the price of, you know, high-speed internet in the United States. Free trade, all right? We've been the architects of free trade. We haven't negotiated a free trade agreement in the last 5 years. We have two pending now, one with Europe, one with Asia. If you don't make it a priority, members of both parties, they are afraid of trade. If you don't go to Congress, say, give me fast-track authority so that if the trade agreement's approved, it has to be voted on up or down, your negotiators can't negotiate a trade agreement, so it won't happen. The reason we got NAFTA in 1994 was because George Bush got fast-track authority in 1992. And this is one of the biggies, capital markets. We rest and think, oh, we're great. We got the best capital markets in the world. This is partly an answer to Charlie's question. I want to talk about both equity and debt. Here's the equity side. One of the things that was great about the United States is access to capital for entrepreneurs. A young company could come public. That was our business in the 90s, taking young companies public. What happened? Well, there was a regulation that said a research analyst can't give information to an investor out that he doesn't do in a press release. So this kind of devalued the value of equity research. Then Elliot Spitzer said, oh my God, there's been a scandal. Let's put research and investment banking totally separate from one another, not even allowed to talk to each other, and you're not allowed to pay research analysts on how much they produce for the firm. And then we had Sarbanes-Oxley, which radically increased the price for a young company of coming public. And first of all, the decimalization of the NASDAQ, right now, it used to be at Robertson Stephens, we would make a quarter or 50 cents on the spread of a young company that you would trade. Today, the spreads are a penny. The net result is the top 20 investment banks on Wall Street have dropped research coverage on about 45% of the names they used to cover, and they've stopped trading about 45% of the names they used to cover. For small cap companies, now this is designed to help the little guy, but for the little guy, there's less research, so there's less information. There's less trading, so there's less liquidity. And I'm telling you, anybody here, if you are individually out there buying stock in a $100 million market cap company, you're crazy, because the hedge fund probably hired the research analyst. They know 10 times more about that stock than you do, so you have to buy an index. But I mean, that is what's happened to our capital markets. And by the way, what is the result? People cannot come public. Small companies cannot come public because the investment banks won't cover them. The institutions won't buy them. So this is a simple thing. You say, okay, that's the number of venture capital-backed IPOs. It used to be about 250 a year. Now it's about anywhere between 20 and 50 a year. And here's another chart that shows the same thing, but in tech. But look at those yellow lines. About 500 a year total IPOs in the United States. Now about 150. Now, you might say, well, who cares? Who cares if a bunch of venture capitalists get rich or whatever? But one of the things that causes somebody to choose to start that global company in America, not in China, not in Singapore, not in wherever, is because it's the best market to come public. You can grow the company with proceeds. Well, the number of companies listed in the United States, while we've been sitting here doing nothing, has gone from 9,000 to 5,000. Okay? The IPO market share of the United States in 2010 and 2011, if you take New York Stock Exchange, NASDAQ, and Toronto together, was 16%. It used to be 70. Now, in 2013, we had a big comeback because the emerging markets fell apart, but we have suffered a loss of IPO market share. Now, some people say it was solved. We passed this bill last year, the Jobs Act. Some people, anybody heard of the Jobs Act? You know, it was a good idea. It's a few things. It said, if you're doing a private placement, not coming public, you can go raise money from a couple hundred people instead of a couple dozen people. It said it made it easier for crowdfunding companies. It said if you're offering 50 or less, you didn't have to file as much paperwork with the Securities Exchange Commission. But the reality is it didn't solve the underlying problem, which is the investment bank still won't take you public at that level. They still won't cover your stock. And so you today to come public, and maybe Rob can answer how big Ascend was when it came public, but I can tell you when Intel Corp came public, they offered $9 million of stock at a $50 million market cap. Okay? Today, you can, and Robertson Stevens, the firm I ran through the 90s, we did, 200 deals a year. We took companies that had about $150 million in value and we raised $50 million for them. That was the normal thing. Today, you can't come public unless you're worth $500 million or more, unless you can offer at least $100 million worth of stock. So the hurdle is so much higher. Now, again, you say, well, it doesn't matter because who cares? Here's why you should care. IHS, Global Insight, the people who did the study on, they found that of all those companies that were venture-backed companies, 92% of the jobs they created came after they had come public. Josh Lerner at the Harvard Business School, Felda Hardiman, Bill Salmon, they run a whole faculty studies the venture capital industry. And they found in venture capital, the best companies drove the returns in the best funds. But those best companies, again, 50% of their job creation was after they came public. So what's happening today in the United States as a result of this? Well, a company that's any good, Ascend waited till after they come public. They were bought by Lucent for, $2.5 billion. But today what happens is venture-backed companies, when they come public, when they get to a certain size, they kind of need another financing when they got, $50 million or something in revenue. And what they're doing, when they get to 50 or 100, when they become worth that much money, they're selling. They're selling in a merger and acquisition transaction, worth $100 or $200 million. A great outcome for the VCs, they're doing their job, but they're not coming public. So for 20 years, venture capitalists who invest in a company, half would exit when the thing came public, and over time they'd sell their shares, and half would exit through the M&A process. Today, 95% of venture exits are being achieved through the M&A market, 5% through the IPO market. And the result, of course, is the venture capital industry has had terrible returns for a decade. The venture capital industry is shrinking. So what does it mean? Okay, here's what it means. You're going to have less venture capital, so you're going to have less company creation. That's what it means. There's a disconnect in our society. People say, well, Wall Street's terrible. I'm here to defend the capital markets. People say, oh, Wall Street, all they've done is, fuel speculation. But by the way, we need more Steve Jobses. Let me tell you about Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs moved to Silicon Valley because his father was working for a company called Spectra Physics. Interestingly, Spectra Physics was the first IPO by Robertson Stevens and Hambrick and Quist, the two companies that took Ascend public. That ecosystem of young investment banks to service tech companies is also going away because you don't have the small cap universe. So say we need more Steve Jobses, but we hate Wall Street and the investment banks. It's like, wait a minute. Apple Computer raised money from the venture capital industry. It came public on the NASDAQ. By the way, the day it came public, it created 330 million millionaires that day. It's one of the great days in the history of American capitalism. And of course, it went on to be one of the most valuable companies in the world, today worth $574 billion. So the takeaway from all this, the summary is that we've been the home of entrepreneurship. We've been the place where capital wants to be invested to create growth and to create companies. We've been the winner of the race for foreign direct investment for decades. But that isn't necessarily going to be true going forward. We have to compete. This just shows FDI into the United States in 2000 was $300 billion a year. In 2012, it was half that. Now, Michael Porter says, how do states, how do countries attract capital? Well, it's a function of their productivity. It's a function of what do people do with the capital. And in the United States, productivity is slowing. Your colleague, the president of the Richmond Fed, just gave a speech this week talking about middling productivity. It also depends what do you have in your location, whether you're a state or a country. And so what I would wrap up with is there's a competition, and the United States needs to be ready to compete. Now, here in Wyoming, by the way, I could go on about California's problems, but I'll skip that slide because it's too depressing. The states are competing with each other. Wyoming has an interesting opportunity.
in that we have a highly educated workforce, we have zero taxes, we have half the energy costs of a lot of places. Matt Mead, the governor, has been doing all the right things. He is investing in broadband right now in this state. He's calling up companies, calling up private equity firms, calling up venture capital, saying, what are you doing in California at three times the cost? Why don't you come to Wyoming? But we as a country need to do that. The reason they have to do it in Wyoming, prosperity isn't a guarantee. Wyoming was 100% dependent on the energy industry and tourism, but mostly energy for many years. This is what happens if you do that. In the 1980s, they lost population and they lost jobs. So now we're trying to diversify. But in this, and what's Matt Mead trying to do, he's trying to not just be an energy producer, but to be someone who adds value in energy afterwards. But what do we need to do as a country? We need to figure out, as the home of entrepreneurship, there was a recent ranking of the best places for entrepreneurship. India was first, Turkey was second, the United States was fourth. Is it going to be one of these other countries or going to be the U.S.? I'll end with good news saying, this is a great time for entrepreneurship. Trade is expanding all around the world. People are getting wealthier. We've had an explosion of global trade in our lifetimes. We have an explosion of the internet. This is a slide I love, that when mobile phones were rolled out, okay, it took 20 years to achieve the first 1 billion subscribers, 3 years to achieve the second 1 billion subscribers, 18 months to achieve the third 1 billion, 9 months to achieve the fourth 1 billion. Couldn't even count the last 3 billion. Now there's 7 billion cell phone subscribers in the world. This is happening right now in the world of smartphones and in the world of tablets. Year over year growth in smartphones, 41% on almost 1 billion units. So we used to worry about the digital divide and everything. Look, everyone in the world is going to have a smartphone in the next year or two. And it's not just going to be Samsung and Apple, because they're selling them for $400, $800. Yulong, Lenovo, Xiaomi, they're going to sell them for less than $100. Everyone will be connected to the internet. And everyone is going to get increasingly educated, which is correlated with success. But the question is, if that's the world we're in, more trade, more access to communications, more education, are we prepared to compete in that world? Because in order to win, we'll have to compete. The good news is it's a great environment for entrepreneurship. The bad news is everyone else, the rise of the rest is occurring, so we better be ready to compete and be the home of entrepreneurship. Thank you.
If you can bring my slides up. Yeah, I was originally going to sing the soprano solo from Gianni Schicchi, but after that opera introduction, I had to do a last-minute shuffle of my slides, so I have to apologize for that. May seem a little distracted because of that. A couple of things to start off, and also with these slides, I figure you're going to see lots of graphs and numbers and stuff like that. So I don't have any. I'm just pictures. It's going to be pictures today, just family vacation pictures mostly. So hopefully you can bear with me. Entrepreneurship, you have those rare few who just have the ability to do things on their own. Most of the successful entrepreneurs really are on the shoulders of giants. And then how I kind of categorize myself is more like Forrest Gump, not particularly smart, but just keep falling into different things accidentally. And I'm going to kind of talk about that a little bit in this slideshow. So when I was a little kid, I always had the normal fantasies about what you want to be when you grow up, a firefighter or a policeman or something like that. And, eventually when I got older, I was really interested in being an actor. And then a friend of mine, his brother worked at he ran a mainframe for a college in Southern California. And I went and saw that and how that thing was put together. And I said, that's what I'm going to be. I'm going to be an electrical engineer when I grow up. And that was exactly, going through high school, what my plan was to be an electrical engineer. And so when I finally got through high school, which career path did I choose? Let's see, does this go down? Yeah. I was a professional ballet dancer. I got to warn you, some of these slides can't be unseen, so if you have any problems with men in tights or dead things, you might want to leave right now. I left California and moved to New York and danced with the Joffrey Ballet, with the Connecticut Ballet, with Ballet Theater Pennsylvania. And I loved what I did. I mean, I absolutely loved it. It was, everything that I did. And one of the things, the problems that I had with it is not that I didn't love what I was doing, but in that career field, you're always around the same people. The same people that know the same things and have the same desires and the same interests and everything else. And it's this kind of microcosm. And I needed something else. I needed to talk to somebody that had something to say that wasn't about what role they wanted to dance or what, you know, company they wanted to be with. And so I just needed to do something else. And I decided that I was going to quit. And this theme's going to come back a lot. My mom, you know, she, you made it. What are you doing? I said, well, I just can't do this anymore. I'm gonna go to school and do something different. And so I applied to New York University. I was living in New York at the time. And I went the path that made the most sense to me. You know, I've been in the arts my whole life and, you know, my young life at this point. And also just one other thing. This is what, you know, 25 years and 60 pounds will do to you. So, you know, I applied to New York University into the Arts Administration program. Made sense, you know, it's what I'd been experienced in and what I knew. And I remember my first day of class, I'm walking up, and the Arts Administration program was in the School of Education, Health, Nursing, and Arts Professions. So it was an NYU school with an identity crisis. And I remember standing on West 4th Street and looking at the building, and my heart sank, and I'm going, what am I doing? I'm trying to get away from this. I'm trying to do something different. And I'm standing on the sidewalk, and right next door, there's this big glass building, and on the top of it, it says Courant Institute of Mathematical Sciences. I thought, you know, I want to do that instead. And so I went next door, and I talked to somebody in admissions over there. And strangely enough, they looked at my test scores, and they said, yeah, come on in. And so I started in the Applied Mathematics program at the Courant Institute of Mathematical Sciences. And soon after, I was hired in the computer science department as a research scientist. And so going from here, So I had to look the role of a research scientist. So this is only a couple years after those last two pictures. I was a research scientist in one of the founders of the Media Research Lab, which was a fantastic time in my life. The Media Research Lab, I was just surrounded by smart people. We had lots of money, grants for doing research. And all I had to do was cool stuff and write about it. I mean, it was like a perfect job. And one of the things that we focused on there was computer graphics research. But we had grants from the Department of Defense for doing image differencing, you know, finding tanks and landscapes. And we had a grant from Apple Computers, and we were working with their voice recognition software, and just lots of money coming in. And really all we had to do was write about it and do neat things. And so some of the neat things we started doing there is called procedural texturing, it started out, and then procedural animation, which was, it really revolutionized the way computer graphics are done today. And it's very rare that you'll see a movie that doesn't use something that came out of this lab. And it was, like I said, an exciting time. And one of the researchers there, Raj, he came up to me once, because what I got interested in when I was at the lab was machine communication, how one computer talked to another, because it mattered back then. It wasn't, you know, as ubiquitous or seamless as it is right now, because we had, you know, spark stations that were, you know, running these procedural animation algorithms. We had Silicon Graphics. We had a big grant from them. They did all the rendering. We had the Apple computers doing the voice recognition. We had all this stuff, and they all needed to talk to each other. And so that was really interesting to me for some reason. And so I started really focusing on machine communication. And I'm getting deep into this. One of the researchers, Raj, he comes up to me and he says, Troy, you got to see what these particle physicists are doing out in Switzerland. And it was really interesting, because at this time, if you wanted to look at a document on somebody's computer, if you wanted to see something that wasn't in your local, you know, your local system, you'd do a remote copy from theirs, and then you would copy this tape archive, and you'd untar it, and then you'd get to the information. And these guys out in Switzerland, they had this thing they called a browser. I'm going, a browser, that's really neat. You can just get this graphical, you know, display of something, and you can click on a link, and it opens the document right there. This is really neat. And it was fascinating to me, so I started writing code to figure out how to make what was originally just static links to static pages. I tried to make it dynamic and started writing code for it. And so we set up a web server at NYU, and I started writing just really simple little programs to take input and output. And like one of my first ones is I wrote just a Magic 8-Ball game. And This was something that you could type in a question. It's just like the, you know, the little toy, and it would give you an answer. You know, ask again later, yes, no, maybe. And being a researcher, I put that on the website just for playing, and I put the source code up there so that anybody could borrow, steal, you know, make it their own and build upon it. And one interesting thing about this, and this can come back a little bit later, one of the things that I also did is I cataloged all the questions. And it was an interesting sociological experiment back then, because as you started cataloging all the questions that people would ask it, number one question was, is there a God? And number two question was, some version of, will I get laid tonight? I always wondered if there was some correlation there. So I've got my research position, and I started writing books, I'm flying around giving talks about, you know, technology, about the internet stuff, and got into Java programming and was writing books about that and doing my research stuff. And I go over to the dean of the school, and I said, hey, we got to put together a program in internet technologies, and when you do, you got to use my book. And he says, well, okay, we're going to do it, but you're going to teach it. So that started my teaching career, which was kind of interesting. I'm a ballet dancer now, teaching at NYU. It was a great time. I absolutely loved teaching. And ended up putting together all the curriculum and hiring the other teachers. And I remember one of the interesting things for me when I thought, hey, I made it, is I'm riding a subway. I lived in Brooklyn. I'm riding a subway into Manhattan. And NYU had bought the whole subway car, and it had all this copy that I'd written for the catalog on it. And I'm going, yeah, hey, I made it. And so then the second year of teaching, I'm getting ready to go teach my class, and I got served a cease and desist letter from Tyco Industries. And apparently Magic 8-Ball is a trademark of Tyco, and they didn't like that I had a big database on there asking if somebody was going to get laid tonight. And they had a problem with that and told me to cease and desist. And so I remember walking in to my class that night, and I'm bouncing off the walls. I've got this cease and desist letter in my hand, and my students are all wondering why I'm so excited. I said, you don't understand. We could all be ham radio operators in our mom's basements, and nobody would care what we were doing, but the world's looking at us. Tyco is protecting trademarks on the internet. I mean, 2 years ago, nobody knew what the internet was. You couldn't say email at a party. Nobody knew what you're talking about. And now Tyco is doing trademark protection. This is going to change the world. It's going to change the way we communicate, change the way we do business. This is going to change everything. And, you know, they kind of looked at me a little cross-eyed, and I quit NYU after that semester. And again, my mom yelled at me. So I was going to go to a startup company, and she's like, well, what's a startup company? And one of the things is a lot of stuff comes out of what you need. I was just so busy back then, you know, giving talks, teaching, research, you know, all the stuff that I was doing, that one of the things that I created just for myself was this personal information management software that did, you know, calendaring, contact management, and scheduling, stuff like that. And just to keep my life straight. And so I decided to make that into a company. I formed a company called WebCal Corporation. And I was a one-person company. It was, you know, I did everything. I was the chief engineer, sales department, everything else. And I got a call from somebody at Schlumberger Well Services out of Austin, Texas. And they wanted a 55,000-seat site license. And, you know, I have no business background. I'm a ballet dancer. What do you say to Schlumberger Well Services? I said, okay, well, $20,000 and, you know, $1,500 a year to maintain it. And they FedExed me a check, and I went, this is bigger than me. And so right after that, I got a call from Exxon, and I sold them a site license. And then from AT&T, and I sold them a site license. And from US West, and so it starts getting bigger and bigger. So I got a bunch of my friends together from NYU, and we, you know, really started the company, WebCal Corporation, you know, as a real going interest with real engineers and, you know, real people. And it was a really exciting time back then, and we're building, you know, the software originally as a groupware product, and then we started doing hosted services, which was starting to come in vogue back then. And I got a call from the New York Times, and they wanted to, you know what we were doing, and they come and interview. And they're saying, okay, well, this is really interesting. Well, what's coming down the pipe? What's next? And I remember, I've still got the article there. We're talking about successes and failures, and some of that is just the paths that you either run out of time for or don't take. And so I've got this New York Times article where I talk about we're going to unroll web-based email. It's going to be great. You don't have to log into your Prodigy account anymore or your CompuServe account, and you know you can get your email from anywhere you have a web browser. And it was a great idea. And it got backburnered, and we were really working on what we were doing. We're doing this big event database and our personal information management stuff. And this company called Hotmail comes out, and you know, we're like, all right, we're not going to chase them. We're doing fine with what we're doing. And we kind of just kind of forgot about that whole project. And then it wasn't that much longer after that, you know, at least in internet time, when Microsoft bought Hotmail for $400 million. And I was just short of, like, you know, punching holes in walls. I'm going, I knew that was a good idea. And so the scary part is shortly after that, you know, it was maybe a couple of weeks after they had closed that transaction, or at least announced that transaction, we got a call from Microsoft. And it scared the heck out of me, you know. Again, you know, with my kind of, you know, background, dealing with a big company like that was pretty scary. So I just sicked the lawyers on them, and they started doing, going back and forth with letters of intent about doing an acquisition. And so we're about, you know, a couple of weeks into that, and I get a call from this company out of Atlanta, Premier Technologies. They were a telecom company. They wanted to buy us. Then I get another one from this company called Puma that did synchronization software for Palm Pilots, if any of you remember those. And they wanted to buy us. And I was just like just sending these all back and forth to lawyers. Crazy time. And so then I got a call from these guys. They were Stanford grad students that had put together a company. And it was they had a product that I didn't really like. It was like a catalog. It wasn't a search engine. It was like a directory of things on the internet. Started out as research papers, and then they started putting other stuff. And what I didn't like about it is it was high quality because everything was put in by humans. It didn't like crawl the internet to find stuff. But the breadth was, you know, it was a small amount of stuff because of that as well. And basically told them, you know, not interested, too much stuff going on. If you've got something really interesting, send it to us. But I really just didn't like what they did. And so about this time, I was running marathons. And I'm sure you can't picture that right now, but I was big into running back then. And I was flying out to California to run the San Diego Marathon. And I kept my calendar public. And one of the guys said, hey, you're going to be in California. Come on up. Let's talk to us. And so I flew up to San Jose after the marathon. And I remember marathons normally run on Sundays. This is Monday, and I'm kind of walking funny and telling them why I can't walk up the stairs and, you know, not feeling 100% myself. And I met with Jerry Yang and David Filo and Tim Kugel and the Yahoo crew. And I remember sitting in this big conference room with Tim Kugel sitting next to me, and he turns to me in these weird wide eyes, and he says, are you passionate? I'm sitting there thinking, how did he answer that? And so anyway, we started talking to the Yahoo crew, and really, there was a lot that they were doing. They had just brought in this company, 411, that had Rocket Mail, which became Yahoo Mail, and this company, Yoyodyne, that did online retail, which was new back then. And they wanted somebody to come in to be the personal information management part. And so I spent the night up there. We came to terms about a pooling of interest merger. And had a board meeting the next day. And a week later, I was living in California. Just left my brownstone in Brooklyn, all my stuff in there. And, you know, a few months later, sent a company to go pack it up. And they packed my trash, which was interesting because it was in storage for a long time. So the beginning of Yahoo, we were in a sea of cubicles. We were in a rented warehouse on Lawrence Expressway, and everybody was in a cube. I like the pager there. That kind of gives you a little timing there. I think I'm still in marathon shape there. So we're in the sea of cubes, and it's kind of interesting because David Filo was just over against the wall there, and people would come visit, and I'd say, hey, do you want to see what a billionaire's cube looks like? But it was fun times. We were masters of the universe, and we knew it. I mean, back in the late 90s, to be at Yahoo was, to be, king of the hill. It was just such an exciting time. And at that time, I was introduced to a guy in Silicon Valley, Ron Conway, who was a pretty well-known angel investor out there. And he was putting together a fund, angel fund that I became involved with. And it was kind of a who's who in Silicon Valley. Like Mark Andreessen was a partner. There was, it was filled with people who had done things like what I had done. And also there were some other, normal Sandhill VCs, like Tim Draper was in there, and some of the big names in Silicon Valley. And that was an exciting time. In the late 90s, you could just throw darts and it worked, And what I did back then, I did some of the technical due diligence and ran some of the pitch sessions. And so this is kind of the 1998 version of Shark Tank. We give them 20 minutes to come in and convince them why we should invest in their companies. And it always felt kind of funny sitting at the end of that conference room table listening to somebody trying to tell me why their company was going to be a great deal. And with my background, I'm just like, well, it sounds good. And, we had some early successes, and what we did as an angel investors is, we do the early stage financing, then hand it up to somebody else, to the normal names, the KPs, the Draper Fishers, the Sequoias, to do the heavy lifting. And we had a number of successes early on. And one of the things that really got me then, it was just so volatile. It's like we had a little investment in this company called Napster, and lost everything on Napster when Metallica shut them down. And then we had another one in Ask Jeeves that was one of the first companies that went public in the fund. And it was an exciting time, but one of the things that really got to me was the volatility of it. I'm going, well, I have no idea this is going to be worth 10x tomorrow or be bankrupt tomorrow. And so I started really looking at what I saw generated multi-generational wealth. And what I saw common amongst people that I thought had multi-generational wealth was they all did it in dirt somehow. So I got really interested in real estate. So people always wonder how I got into self-storage from this kind of a background. And so I started doing multifamily deals, started doing land entitlement deals, and quickly realized that was another flavor of venture. And then somebody introduced me into self-storage, and so I started buying these self-storage facilities, which is actually a great, great business. And so I left technology, totally burnt out in 2001. And, of course, my mom yelled at me again. And wanted to figure out what I wanted to be when I grew up. I just saw I got a two-minute warning, so I'm going to get through these next ones really, really quick. And I always thought I'd, just do something, do my real estate investing and, open a brew pub or something. And so to kind of clear my mind, I went out to Alaska, went moose hunting. And the reason this is significant, I'll just spend a couple of seconds on this, is because it was a real life changer. I didn't see any moose on this island anywhere. This is northern Alaska. This was my camp. That's my taxidermist up there hanging out in our kitchen. And we got dropped off by a bush pilot in that plane that I just showed you, just the two of us, for a little shy of a month, and shot this big old moose. I got to warn you, I'm going to show something dead in a second. Shot this big old moose. I'll go back so you don't have to stare at it. We've got these aviation radios so that we can call if we see a bush pilot fly through, or Japan Airlines doing the polar route to Asia. We can send a message back to Dillingham to come pick us up. And there's no planes flying. And it took us, 2,000 pounds of moose. We had to hike back to camp, which is about a 2-mile hike and then about an 8-mile boat ride. They actually tied a boat to an airplane and flew it out to us. And when it finally finished, I knew something bad had happened. And I'm talking to Jerry. I'm saying, something really bad's happened. I don't know what, but we haven't seen any contrails, no bush pilots, no anything. And so we decided that if they didn't come pick us up on our pickup date, which was September 16th, we needed a hike. And we were 1,000 miles from Anchorage, so it was probably a year hike. A couple of glaciers and, some lakes and whatever. And so finally, on the 16th, this plane comes in, that Grumman Goose I showed you earlier, lands on the lake, taxis into shore. The guy, pilot, opens the window. He's still sitting in the plane and sticks his head out, and he goes, "Hey, guess what?" "What?" "So they blew up the World Trade Center." "Who?" And he made some expletives, and I'm still trying to figure out what's going on. I said, "Both of them?" "Yeah, it took them both down." And I'm picturing both of these towers just falling out over and taking out lower Manhattan. And having spent most of my adult life in lower Manhattan, it really, really affected me. It affected me to the point that, I remember going out on the boat while they're packing up the plane, and I'm floating around out there, and I'm crying. And one of the things that really got me is, you know, I grew up in a pretty simple family. You know, I was basically a single-parent family. My parents divorced pretty early, and my mom was a checker in a grocery store, you know, raising three kids on her own. You know, those sacrifices I'm, you know, amazed at and proud of her for. And I had spent my entire life just crawling and scraping and bettering myself and using all the opportunities that I had as an American. And it really, really bugged me that we were being attacked, and I had never done anything about that. And I'd never given back. And it really, you know, really affected me. And I knew I was going to do something, but I didn't know what at that time. And go back to there. And I had, you know, four kids, a wife, and, you know, a family and whatever. And so I get back to, I got stuck in Canada for a while because the airspace was closed. I couldn't fly over Canada. I got stuck in Alaska, so I couldn't fly over Canada. And they finally opened the airspace. And so I flew down to back to San Jose. And the next day I walked into a recruiter's office and joined the Air Force. And my mom yelled at me. You did what? So I go in there and I take they tell me I have to take this ASVAB. And what's that? You know, this vocational aptitude test. And I have to do my physical. And I walked in. I said, hey, I've got a commercial pilot's license. I've always been an avid aviator. You know, I used to teach at NYU. What can you do with me? And they brought in this guy, Chief Rhodes. And he was with the 129th Rescue Squadron. And he says, hey, here's what we do. We fly 22,000-pound helicopters in two-ship formation, 50 feet off the deck with night vision goggles on. And we find busted up kids out in the desert and we bring them home. I went, I'm in. And so I got shipped off. There's my daughter pinning my wings off. And to go through these real quick. So you know, I was flying H-60s in Afghanistan. I ended up doing two tours out there. Did about 200 combat support missions and 20 rescues. So I got 20 kids home. Yeah, there's my crew. Just go through these real quick. There's the dream team right there. And go through these quickly. Yeah, now picture the guy over there with my blood type on my shoulder, you know, next to that first picture I showed you in tights. Oh, this was doing some, we do these hearts and minds missions when we come off alert and go in and set up, you know, bring toys and food and set up clinics in these little villages, which is actually great. But it was the scariest time that I was ever there because my normal mission was flying in the middle of the night with night vision goggles on, and actually being out in a village in daylight was pretty scary. And my hat's off to those kids that do that all the time. And, oh, yeah, we had Canadians there, so we had a hockey team in Kandahar, you know, so that was our R&R. So all that, you know, whole story, just comes down to, like I said, my Forrest Gump kind of life, you know, just keep falling into things. And what I'm doing right now in self-storage is something that has just been part of that growth from being, you know, crazy volatile to doing something that was containable. But I still think we're going to do something big out of this in, you know, building these cash flow portfolios and doing something interesting with it. And just to close in my last couple of seconds, I know he really wants me off. You know, one other thing I just wanted to plug really quick, if anybody's interested, because this seemed really like a crowd that, you know, especially with the, you know, Bronze Buffalo Club and the Cast and Blast and everything, this is something that I do that's really close to my heart. And if anybody's ever interested in this, you know, just give me a call. But, you know, I'm involved with Warriors in Quiet Waters, and we take traumatically wounded veterans on fly fishing trips as therapy to get past their injuries. And it's just been, you know, something that has been great for me, hard for me, but great. And it's something I'm very passionate about. We try to get them pretty soon after their injuries so that it's part of their therapy, getting their minds off of all the stuff they're going through and helping them move forward. If anybody's ever interested in that, just my email, I didn't put it on here, troy@yahoo. It's pretty easy to remember. Just send me a note, and you know, I'll send you some information. So I went horribly right. Over time, and I apologize for that. But
right. Let's thank the panel. Charlie, Bob, Rob, Troy, great stories. You inspire us. I will tell you, Troy, that some of us in this room were in the World Trade Center. I was one of them. My colleague Bob Eisenbeis, I think there's a few more. And given the choice, the Moose was a better place to be. We are going to go immediately to the municipal bond session. They're going to change the panels now.